a part of our liturgy.
See, I can hit a button. You know. Well, okay. Welcome. I should say welcome for the ride. I don't know what's in store. I'm the captain flying the plane this morning. So most of you know me. I'm the Reverend Maureen Ausbrook. A lot of people just call me Rev Mo. Mo or Maureen, it all works. Our pastor, Ian Lynch, can't be here today, and I have the honor of filling in. So I do a lot of filling in. I do a lot of pulpit fill. And probably in the last 11 months, I've been to 7 churches. So everybody does it a little differently. And it's kind of confusing. I'm relying on help here for the technology. And if you've ever been in one of my services before, you know I'm not a stickler for the rules or the program even. Sometimes I just throw it all out. So let us enter into a state of prayerfulness. Let's do this by reciting the mission statement of this church. It's on the first page. This is also up on the screen.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, it's right here.
Yeah. Oh, there we are.
There we are. See, it'll work out. Yeah. If nothing, God's got a sense of humor. Seeking to walk in the way of Jesus, we're an open and affirming church, faithfully using who we are and what we have to serve those in the margins of our community. No matter who you are, where
you are in life's journey,
you are welcome here. Right off the bat, I see that we're out of order.
It's all good.
It's all good. We said our mission statement. And now I need to say you're all welcome here in case you didn't know that. But you know you are. You're loved here. You're safe here. This particular service came together through the help of a lot of people. A lot of people are still helping us. I wanted to share, I won't do it later, I'll just do it now. Hopefully we're going to be able to see a video at the end of this service. Kyle Oliver, I think, is going to make it happen. There was a piece of music I saw on the internet. It was a video. It was really beautiful. It really moved me. In fact, I cried while I was watching it. I was so moved, I said, I really want to play this. I want to play this Sunday. So there was a way to contact this black choir in Maryland. And I called the church. They were thrilled to hear from me. I spoke to the music director. I told her who I was and that I was going to be doing a service at a little, very white church in Maine. And I miss diversity because I come from the big city. But I was very moved by their video. And I wanted permission to use it. I asked if we could make a contribution to their church. How could this be? And they were so gracious. This woman, Linda Plater, said, oh my Lord, don't make any donation at all. Just play it, please. She said, it's our gift to the world. And she said, we send it to you with love and grace. So I think that's a really beautiful opening to this service, to share that. Okay, David, let's go.
All right.
You hit it, buddy. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and also with you. I call you all to take this moment to pass the peace, to greet each other with love and charity and welcome them here. I seem to see many of the same faces, but a few new ones. Is that Sarah? And to you out in the internet, if you see this later, we send you our peace and our love. Hi, Sarah. Is that Sarah? Yes. Okay, we were praying you'd be here today, and I didn't see you, but then Kyle came and saved us. Welcome, everybody. All right. Regina, would you like to lead us in prayer of invocation?
Please join me in the prayer of invocation. O God of the morning and the evening hours, O timeless and eternal God, creator of all, we come before you this Sabbath day to give you thanks and praise. Our hearts are filled with gratitude as we give you thanks and praise. O Mother, Father, God, the one and only God that we cannot adequately name, let your grace renew and restore us and fill us with the fire of your unending love. We ask this all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let me try that again. Sorry about that.
Scripture reading this morning is one of the most famous passages in Christian scripture. Oh, and I just wanted to share this. It often shows up in wedding ceremonies, and it's sometimes enjoyable to explain to the groom that this love is about brotherly love and loving everybody else. It's not just romantic love. I've had young couples look at me incredulously. They really thought that Paul was speaking to marital love. But he's not. He's speaking about the love of Christ and how Christ loves us. And now Regina will read us the passages from 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13.
It's one of my favorite passages in the Bible. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up my childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. But now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, but the greatest of these is love. I'm going to read together when it comes up on the screen, the Prayer for Peace by Saint Francis of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that I may not seek to console as to console, to understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is dying that we are born to eternal life. Thus ends our readings for today.
Could I have some water?
I'll get you one.
Would you? Thank you. You remember Linus?
Mm-hmm.
From Peanuts? I love mankind. It's people I can't stand. I think we can agree that the news is too often heartbreaking, infuriating, and depressing. Thank you very much. And from what I can tell, everyone feels this way. No matter what side of the cultural divide they may be on, it seems like everybody today is mad at everybody else. I find myself fed up with the lies, corruption, and the great travesties that I see. So I get Linus. Another thing people often say is they love their pets more than people. We've heard that. So I was thinking about Paul, the Apostle Paul. I was thinking of what he felt. He was arrested 3 times, and scholars tell us that he was probably in Roman custody 5.5 years. What was he thinking while he was waiting a prisoner of empire, first under house arrest, and then waiting for his execution from within a cold Roman jail cell? Of course, he was human. The apostles and disciples were. But I kind of think he might have been saying something like this. Okay, so right now, Lord, I really, really can't stand these Romans. I think we could forgive him for that. So has the world always been this messed up? Probably, yes. But I agree with Martin Luther King, who said that the arc of the moral universe bends towards justice. But I think it's fair to ask us, what role has religion played in this bending of the arc of the moral universe? It seems especially important to me as Christians to ask how it plays out in society, what role we play. Because what is the arc of the moral universe if it's not us? Another question, have you ever wondered how anyone can really love an enemy? Or a person who acts or speaks in a way that's repugnant to us? How do you love a racist while at the same time making it clear that you are opposed to racism? What does that look like? Is it an I'm okay, you're okay, smarmy kind of cultural relativism? I hope not. Is an arsonist the same as a firefighter? In today's turbulent and cultural times, this is not an academic, purely scholastic, religious question. Someone recently asked me if I could cite one single time in history where love, an act of love, changed history. Aside from the crucifixion, which certainly changed history, at the moment I couldn't think of anything. But strangely enough, maybe not so strangely, that very afternoon the Interfaith Observer came to me through my email, and that is an excellent magazine with contributors from all over the world of every faith tradition and many philosophers. There's usually always something very important, very touching in there. In this particular issue, we printed a message that the author, Betsy Woodman, delivered to the congregation of the Unitarian Universalist Church in Andover, New Hampshire, this past Easter. And wouldn't you know that her message was about the redemption of George Wallace through Christian love? Right on cue, I had my racist. You know who George Wallace is, I assume, if you're of a certain age. I will gladly send anybody this whole article in its entirety if you ask for it, and I'm liberally taking from it, but I'm telling you that this is not necessarily her research, but research she compiled about George Wallace, but it's not actually what we commonly hear. And those of us like me who grew up with the image of George Wallace, the racist we love to hate, I knew none of this. I knew none of what happened to George Wallace. So to recap, Wallace was a four-term governor of Alabama, ran three times for the presidency, and he was a virulent segregationist. At his 1963 inauguration for governorship in Alabama, he infamously vowed, segregation now, segregation tomorrow, segregation always. That same year, he tried to prevent two black students from enrolling at the University of Alabama. And it was on his watch, quite arguably, because of much of his hateful rhetoric, that the Ku Klux Klan planted dynamite in a Birmingham church, killing four little black girls. Wallace was Alabama's governor in 1965 during the Civil Rights March from Selma to Montgomery. John Lewis, who was then a young civil rights activist and went on to become a revered US congressman, led 600 people over the Edmund Pettus Bridge. They were met by state troopers who unleashed dogs, tear gas, hoses, clubs, fire hoses. And John Lewis himself was so brutally beaten, he was left with a severe skull fracture. Martin Luther King called George Wallace the most dangerous racist in America. Then 7 years later, while campaigning for the presidency in the Democratic primary, Wallace was shot. I was 21 at the time. And I'll tell you truthfully, I thought it couldn't happen to a more deserving creep. Shame on me. But that's where I was then. Coming of age at a time where I'd already seen three men I considered far better already assassinated. Wallace was left with five bullets in his spine, paralyzed for life. He spent the rest of his life in a wheelchair and in constant pain. Nevertheless, he ran again for governor and was reelected twice. So that's a historical record. That's kind of what I think many of us recall. But Bessie Woodman, in her research, shared with us his Christian redemption. It seems that the Congresswoman, Shirley Chisholm, you may remember her, was one of the first people to visit Wallace in the hospital. That's kind of hard to imagine. She was the first Black woman to do so, but what really struck me is how different things were politically then. Both Shirley Chisholm and George Wallace were running in the same primary. Wallace stood against everything Shirley Chisholm stood for. He opposed everything she fought for. When he saw her, he asked, "Aren't your supporters going to be angry with you that you're here?" Chisholm said, "Yes, they are. But I wouldn't want what happened to you to happen to anyone else." Wallace's daughter said that her father cried and cried and cried. Was it Shirley Chisholm who planted a seed, dare I call it a mustard seed, of transformation in Wallace's soul? We might say she didn't do anything more than show up. But it was no small act for a Black woman to walk into a hospital room of a white male, well-known racist in power. I wonder what triggers she had to overcome. What does she have to push down? What well of faith does she have to pull from? I see it as an enormous act of courage and faith. Lying in a hospital bed, Wallace then had a lot of time to think. And he began to call people he had wronged. In each call, he poured out his remorse and asked for their forgiveness. One of the people he called was John Lewis, the man whose skull was fractured while Wallace was governor. Wallace acknowledged the suffering he caused others. He believed his paralysis was punishment for his sins, and he sought atonement as a born-again Christian. He came to believe that being shot saved his soul. In 1979, Wallace made an unannounced visit to a Sunday service at the Dexter Avenue Church in Montgomery, Alabama. That's the church where Martin Luther King Jr. had been pastor. And he begged forgiveness from the congregation. The congregation, believing in the power of forgiveness and seeing in Wallace a new man, granted him their forgiveness. As a state trooper wheeled out the paralyzed Wallace, someone started to sing "Amazing Grace," and the whole church joined in. Amazing grace indeed. Wallace's conversion from a segregationist to an integrationist changed Alabama history. It might be one of the most astounding stories of the era. He appointed 160 African Americans to Alabama state offices. He put two Blacks in his own cabinet. He hired a Black press secretary. He pushed for and signed legislation that benefited the poorest Blacks in rural Alabama. This included increased financing for rural education and healthcare, and improved highways through Black districts. He eradicated loan sharking and made it harder to repossess cars, both scourges of the poor. Cynics dismiss Wallace's professed change of heart as merely an electoral ploy. But leaders in the African-American community didn't see it that way. The great Black historian, John Hope Franklin, believes Wallace underwent a true metamorphosis and became a courtly, kindly person and a true Christian. By the time Wallace ran for governor for the last time in 1987, he won 90% of the Black vote in Alabama. A University of Alabama poll found that 74% of Black voters rated Wallace the best governor the state had ever had. Wallace died in 1998, and Congressman John Lewis wrote this in the New York Times: "Rarely does our country witness such a conversion by an elected official. Such a conversion of principle can be shaped only by courage and conviction, through genuine repentance and forgiveness. The soul of our nation is redeemed." Alabama writer Diane McWhorter observed that Wallace uttered three words that were probably never uttered so publicly before from the Old South, and they were, "I was wrong." Saying "I was wrong" is one step toward a new relationship. The other person can then say, or message by their presence, as Shirley Chisholm did, that "I believe you are very wrong, but I still love you, and I do not want you harmed." And that, I would suggest to you today, is what Paul's letter to the Corinthians is all about. Now is a time in our service where we share our joys and concerns. I have here prayer request forms. This is from the Oliver family, Bethany, Kyle, and Regina, asking for continued prayers for Herb as he is still hospitalized and is recovering, hoping to come home this week. This is our prayer. From Laura, prayers for Evie Flood, who had hip surgery on Wednesday. She is home, her spirits are good. She will be on crutches a minimum of 6 weeks. We pray for her healing. This is our prayer. Thank you. From Shawnee, a prayer request for Kirby, as she is very sick and alone on the road to move to Maine. This is our prayer. From Nancy Godfrey, she has a joy to share with us. She says, "So many of my family and lots of friends came to a 70th birthday party for my daughter-in-law, Cheryl. It was so much fun."
This is our prayer.
I have prayers for my girlfriend, Susan, who's battling breast cancer. I have prayers for one of my best friends, Sue Conway Matsunaga, who lost her husband, Bruce, on Monday. I was in their wedding 50 years ago. Prayer for both of them. Can we hear prayers from those who are online?
Continuing prayers for the hungry and the homeless.
This is our prayer.
I want to add a prayer. Didn't want to forget this. I want to add a prayer for our friends in Canada suffering from these wildfires.
My prayer.
And with that goes our prayer for Mother Earth. I want to also remember, and I thank Nancy Sanford for always doing this, the poor and the homeless. I want to especially remember a woman I met this week through my ministry, Starfish Village. She needs our prayers.
This is our prayer.
I also want to remember our pastor, Ian, and his family. Gina and Angel, as they travel this weekend, may their travels be safe.
This is our prayer.
Are there any more?
Prayers for my mom, who's going through some health struggles.
Our prayer.
And prayers for everybody in the LGBTQ community as they celebrate various pride weekends and parades, that everything be safe and that the events be filled with love.
It's our prayer.
This is a joy. My grandson, Ben, who's 18, is graduating today. Molly's brother.
This is our prayer.
Let us then conclude our prayers with the prayer that our Lord gave us, the prayer of Jesus. Say the one that's in your heart. If the traditional one is not the one you prefer. Our Creator in heaven, holy is your name. Your
kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread. We forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the part of the service where we traditionally talk about the offering. As for an offering, COVID changed so much, you know. We're not passing a plate and all that as we used to do. Some of you who have been in this church a while and remember us when we were over on Eustace Parkway, remember when we would maybe walk down the aisle with toilet paper, things like that. That was a lot of fun. I kind of miss that, actually. But I want to remind people online, people on Facebook, people here, you can certainly join us online. You can give to this church through a portal at our website. And I want to thank the people of this church who not only give so graciously of their money and support the missions of this church, but who also donate their love and their labor. Is this the time I should stop and we do a creation care moment? Who's delivering that today? Okay.
Someone.
Let's hear it. Huh?
Well, this is some good news from the Maine Nature Conservancy I thought I'd share with you today. Two key properties totaling 13,640 acres in the Western Maine Mountains, Quill Hill and Perham Stream, have been permanently protected. All the acreage will be open for public use and a majority will continue to be managed with timber harvest. This conservation project was led by Trust for Public Land, the Nature Conservancy in Maine, and the State of Maine's Bureau of Parks and Lands. Public funding was awarded through the Land and Water Conservation Fund Forest Legacy Program, which is administered by the U.S. Forest Service and the Department of Defense's Readiness and Environmental Protection Integration Program. These lands are part of the traditional territory and of ongoing cultural significance to the Wabanaki people. They are also key parts of a priority landscape for enhancing carbon storage and ensuring species can adapt to a changing climate. Quill Hill and Perham Stream are vitally important to the region's economy, outdoor recreation, forest products industry, climate resilience, wildlife habitat, healthy watersheds, and quality of life. They are prominent in the landscapes, visible from the Appalachian Trail, Mount Abram, and the Rangeley Lake Scenic Byway, and are adjacent to the Wilderness Training Facility operated by the U.S. Navy. And it just goes on to explain about the property and what's so beneficial about them. But Governor Mills says, I'm thrilled that future generations will be able to experience the unmatched beauty of the Western Maine Mountains from Quill Hill to Perham Stream. This extraordinary collaborative conservation project will preserve access to some of the most breathtaking vistas in the state and set aside thousands of acres of land for recreation and wildlife habitat that will benefit generations to come.
I want to add that I'm very grateful when Ian reminds us every Sunday that we stand on Wabanaki land. People who cared for this earth. Oh, yes. Jackie wants to remind us that there are, Jackie, what are those cards? Can you bring me up one? For the love of creation, give us climate justice. If you haven't filled one out yet, you can. You're in the back. 2 seconds to fill it out. 2 seconds. I should keep you here and make everybody fill one out. Okay. So this is going to work, right, Kyle? Well, you know, you got backup here. She's hiding her head, but, you know, never shy away from owning your great gifts. The Lord gave them to you. All right, let it rip. We had the music before, we couldn't get the video. No, no. Amen. Blessings, blessings.
talking about a happy day. We're 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 talking about a happy day. Wow, a happy day. Bring it down now. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're talking about a happy day. Wow. Say a happy day. Oh, we're talking about a happy day.
Inspirational.
Thank you.
I love that. Let's conclude our service with this benediction. You'll recognize it. It's kind of a variation on a famous Irish prayer. May the raindrops fall lightly on your brow. May the soft winds freshen your spirit. May the sunshine brighten your heart. May the burden of the day rest lightly upon you. And may God enfold you in the mantle of his love. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen. Amen. With that, this service is concluded, but we still have things to talk about. So stay put.
Okay.
So what we want to discuss, I think, is announcements. Anybody have anything to announce? There it is. We have, let's not forget about this. Our missions committee is hosting this, along with the UU Church in Waterville, who reached out to us to do something together. And so on Friday, June 16th at 6:30 over at the UU Church, we're going to see the Marty Stevens Improv Theater. They're putting together an improv, it's called Challenges of Aging. The theater explores through short vignettes, varying important issues which lead to discussions. It's free admission and potluck desserts. So who wouldn't go to potluck desserts? Donations are accepted for the Waterville Interfaith Council. Yeah. And then our friends over at the Episcopal Church, St. Mark's, remind us of the dedication of the walking prayer labyrinth. You've not seen it, it's beautiful. It's Wednesday, June 21st at 4 p.m. St. Mark's. Do we have something else here? Oh, don't want to miss this. Coffee Fellowship next week. Well, why didn't you have it when I'm here? Come on. All right.
Wow.
And now we're just going to do our postlude.
Well, just a vamp off what we were listening to.